Part 2. New vistas in the short story. Backgrounds in other lands.
Ranging freely across the globe, the short story often opens new vistas for the reader, provides him with insights into unusual people and places. Locales vary widely. Big town, small town, mountain, jungle, desert, sea. From O. Henry's glittering and raucous old New York to Sinclair Lewis's slothful Gopher Prairie. From Kipling's regimental British India to Somerset Maugham's exotic South Seas.
A short story with such an unusual locale is Selma Lagerlöf's powerful work, The Outlaws. Here in the frozen forests of Sweden, hidden in its darkest shadows, venturing out only with the greatest care, are two fugitives. One is the tall, brawny peasant Berg, who had murdered a monk. The other, his helper and admirer, young Tord, the 16-year-old fisherman, offspring of a witch and a thief.
Again and again, the men hunting the peasant Berg try to tempt Tord to betray his friend, to no avail. But one day while all nature rages, the once heathen Tord, ironically converted by the slayer Berg, decides that his friend must pay for his sins. Running off to the town, he impetuously alerts a band of men, promising to lead them to Berg's hiding place.
Tord returns alone, scattering peas behind him to guide the men to the cave. While he waits, Tord implores Berg to repent, without revealing he has already betrayed him. To the boy's amazement, Berg breaks down, penitent and full of self-reproach. Wild with regret at his hasty action, Tord blurts out what he has done, begs Berg to flee with him before the men arrive. But Berg, enraged at the boy's act, gropes for his axe to kill him. In self-defense, Tord snatches his own axe, strikes first, splitting Berg's head open.
The peasants came rushing in. They rejoiced and praised the deed. "You will win by this," they said to Tord.
Later, Tord lay beside the body, talked to it, wept, and begged the dead man to awake. The peasants arranged a bier. When they lifted him on the bier, Tord rose, shook the hair back from his face, and said in a voice which shook with sobs,
"Say to Un, who made Berg Rees a murderer, that he was killed by Tord the fisherman, whose father is a wrecker and whose mother is a witch, because he taught him that the foundation of the world is justice."
Another striking locale for a short story is a lonely island in the South Pacific, setting for Somerset Maugham's masterful and suspense-filled tale, Red. Two men, a handsome sailor and a mysterious Swede, are involved in a curious triangle with a native woman. To the Samoan lagoon early in the story comes a brute of a captain, a gross hulk of a man, disembarking from his freighter and entering the native village by a rude and precarious bridge. Soon he comes to a house where he finds the strange and embittered Swede, Nielsen, who had come there to recover his health 25 years before. Nielsen lives now among the islanders, owner of a vast personal library and attended only by an aging native wife, spinning out his days on the lagoon.
Drinking with Nielsen, the captain listens to his tale of a haunting love affair, of Sally, a beautiful native woman in love with an American sailor called Red, a young Adonis with flaming red hair who deserts from his ship and comes to live in idyllic bliss with a girl. But one day, while boarding a passing ship to trade for tobacco, Red is carried off and impressed into service, leaving the broken and dispirited girl behind. Nielsen, deeply infatuated with her, finally prevails upon her to marry him. But though she lives with him, she does so without feeling, constantly tortured by her memories of Red.
Suddenly, in the midst of his story, the Swede stops short. Troubled by the feeling that he has known something of his visitor before, He asked the captain his name.
The skipper's face puckered, and he gave a cunning chuckle. He looked then malicious and horribly vulgar.
It's such a damn long time since I heard it that I almost forgot it myself. But for 30 years now in the islands, they've always called me Red.
A moment later, Sally, now grown old and stout, enters, and Nielsen sits petrified. But neither she nor Red, once such ecstatic lovers, recognize each other. Later, Sally asks Nielsen casually who his visitor was.
He's the captain of a schooner. He's from Apia.
Yes.
He brought me news from home. My eldest brother is very ill, and I must go back.
Will you be gone long?
He shrugged his shoulders.
A Swedish forest, a South Sea isle. Certainly unusual settings for a short story. But surely even more unique is the locale for this next work, The Sniper, by Liam O'Flaherty, staged on the rooftops of the city of Dublin.
The time is the year of the Irish Revolution, and the opposing factions, the Republicans and the Free Staters, are waging civil war.
On a rooftop near O'Connell Bridge, a Republican sniper lay watching. Beside him lay his rifle, and over his shoulders was slung a pair of field glasses. His face was the face of a student, thin and ascetic, but his eyes had the cold gleam of the fanatic. The eyes of a man who is used to look at death.
Across the way, also solidly entrenched and hidden from sight, is a Free Stater, his remorseless enemy, sworn to destroy him. For hours, the two wage their deadly duel, plotting and calculating every delicate move, until finally the Republican sniper lures his enemy out of cover and kills him.
But suddenly, struck by a strange desire to learn the identity of the dead sniper, the Republican soldier hurries across the street, oblivious of the rain of bullets.
A machine gun tore up the ground around him with a hail of bullets, but he escaped. He threw himself face downward beside the corpse. The machine gun stopped. Then the sniper turned over the dead body and looked into his brother's face.